on 6.6 density. In here, you might have learned what is density in primary school, but now let's take a look at it in more details on what is the basic ideas of what density are. Now in here, there's an example of a bicycle and how they're going to be racing against each other in the Olympics. And they're using lighter and lighter material. For example, in this case, they used to use aluminum for the frame of the bicycle. But you see the black stuff over there? They actually replaced that with the carbon fiber. Or some of it might use a triple version, which is a fiberglass. And it's a lot lighter, and it can be as strong as steel, or stronger than steel, actually. And some of the secrets of it is by reducing its weight. In this case, we'll be looking at density. So in here, let's take a look at the first video of comparing different materials.
Your teacher will give you several blocks. They have the same volume, but are made of different substances. Measure the volumes and the masses of the blocks. Record the results. Do all the blocks have the same mass?
Okay, so in here, you can tell that we have four different types of material we'll be comparing with. And the weight and the volume of each, you can say that this is the dimension of all the dimensions. The width, the height, and the length for all of it are the same. So you can use these three numbers to represent the volume. And in here, you see this is the wood's density, the wood's mass. And you've got plastic. And this is the weight of the plastic. And you copy this down. Okay, so at least you have two numbers you can compare with. And you can do the calculations on the density afterwards. And now, let's go back to the textbook and answer some questions. So in here, there are four different types of materials, and again, all of them have the same dimensions, so the answers would be different in some of the marks. So do all the rocks have the same marks? The answer is no. All of them will have different weights. In the experiments above. So we have different materials, they have different mass, but they have the same volume. That's why, because of different substance, they have different densities. So what is density? Density is the mass per unit volume. So in here you see that the mass is in terms of gram or kilogram. It's per volume. So it's divided by the volume. In here it's cm cubed or meter cubed. So in our experiment we'll be using with cm cubed, we will not use this unit. It's a bit too big for us. So in here we use cm cubed. So here's an example of iron. It has a density of 7.9 gram per cm cube. So in here, if you have one of this block of 1 cm cube, the weight would be 7.9 gram. That's what it means by this unit. I think gram per cm cube. That's what we will be measuring. Now here, so there's a list of materials. You see that lead is a lot heavier. So that's why one reason why we call this a heavy metal, because it's really heavy. It's almost 1.5 times heavier than iron, and for aluminum it's almost like 5 times as heavy. So that's why lead is a heavy metal. And mercury, you see that it's heavy as well, it's even heavier than lead in terms of the density. And here is worth noting is in here we use water. It's not seawater. Seawater is different. It has salt in it. But in the pure water without salt, we use as a standard. So 1 gram of it will be in 1 cm cube. In here, this is the standard. So everything will be comparing to pure water. That's why you see here it's 1. And in your last question, in the charge question in the Google Classroom, you see that ice is the answer because it's 0.9 gram per cm cube. Compared to water, actually this solid is lighter than water, lighter weight than water. You can see that if it's the same 1 cm cube. The difference is when you are cooling it down, it actually will be lighter weight as well. And lighter weight, but the volume it remains the same. And here you see that air actually has weight. If you measure 1 cm cube of it, you have 0.001 gram of weight. So in here you actually measure air, actually it has a weight of it. And in our last video, we have seen the atmospheric pressure. All this weight is going to come up on your body, breathing down on you, and that will generate the mass that's actually putting force on you, which is the atmospheric pressure. Now, in here, what is density? We are comparing in terms of equal volumes. So in here, some substance that we can measure with the equal volumes. So in here, we can see that iron has a higher density than aluminum, because if you have the same block or the same size, you can tell that one is 7.9, the other one is only 2.7. This one is way heavier, so iron is a lot heavier than aluminum. So in here you can tell that if you use the same amount of iron, you will be a lot heavier in terms of the volumes. That's why if you have the cars from the 50 years ago, they use iron to make those cars in America. The US muscle cars are a lot heavier because of this reason. Nowadays, people tend to use aluminum or other materials, composites, and it's a lot lighter just because of this reason. The density is a lot lower. So nowadays, all the cars in BMW or all the European class Mercedes, they will use aluminum frames just because of this reason. Now here, as I mentioned, the low density material of carbon fibers, that's what they're using here, carbon fibers. You can look it up. Actually, carbon fibers is actually a really good material to work with. Airplanes, fighter jets, boats, racing boats use carbon fibers. And some of the top-end race cars also use carbon fibers. Formula One cars use this as well. And it's an expensive material to work with. And you buy something to try to work it. And actually it's fun to work with. So in here, you can find out more on your own how to use this material. Okay, so let's answer some questions. So in here, density is the mass per unit volume of a substance. Its unit is in gram per cm magnetic field or Hilbert per meter cube. So in here, how do we do the calculations? We do it by knowing the mass and the volume. Because density is equal to mass per volume, or mass divided by volume, mass over volume. So you see, that's why in science it's important to know your units. It's grams per cm cube. It's grams divided by cm cube. That's what this unit means. So in here, it's important to know this unit. And here is an example of calculating for a block of wood. Here, we got 150 grams, and we got the volume of 300 cm cube. And in here, make sure we have the units. And what is the density? It's 150 divided by 300, which is 0.5 gram per cm cube. Now in here, this is one of the lightest material we have found, and it's made by Owen, and I will show you what this looks like. So in here, if you type in lightest material, the first picture we come up with is this microlattice. So let's take a look at the video.
We were able to make the world's lightest material. The entire structure was basically 99.99% air. The microlattice is a 3D open cellular polymer structure and can often be compared to something like a bone structure. In your bone structure, the outside of your bone is very rigid, but on the inside, it's actually mostly hollow, where you basically have an open cellular structure, so they aren't easily crushed, yet lightweight at the same time. If you want to look at just properties in general, then one would be compression in the sense of energy absorption, and then the second would be lightweight in terms of having very hollow tubes. So let's say you have the A drop challenge that a lot of students have in school, and they need to drop an egg from 25 stories and protect that egg. They would probably wrap it in many, many layers of bubble wrap and then drop it and hope for the best. But what we can do is back design the microlattice to absorb the force that the egg feels. So instead of having an egg that's wrapped in 3 feet of bubble wrap, now you have a much smaller package that your egg can fit in. One of the main applications that we've been looking into is structural components or aerospace. So when I get on an airplane and I'm leaning against the sidewall panel, putting my luggage in the stove in, or if I'm walking along the floor panels, I think the microlattice could be used in one of these applications. In the future, the material can help Boeing to save a lot of weight, make the airplanes more fuel efficient. It's really exciting to be able to work with things that we make that can eventually go into a real product that a lot of users can interact with.
Okay, so this is the first one on the microlattice. And the second one I want to introduce you to is this one. It looks like gel, it's called air gel. So let's take a look.
This is air gel, the world's lightest, that is least dense solid. This piece has a mass of just 1.22 grams. That is only a few times the mass of the same volume of air, which kind of makes sense because it is 99.8% air. In fact, some aerogels are so light that if you removed all the air from them, they would be less dense than air. I have long been fascinated by aerogels, so I actually flew out to aerogel technologies in Boston to find out, why was aerogel invented? How is it made? Why is it such a good thermal insulator? And what is it used for? Okay, we are going to try an experiment to demonstrate the insulating power of aerogels. So over here we have two setups, one with a glass petri dish, the other one with aerogel on top. Both are made of silica, but with very different physical structures. We're going to see how long it takes to melt these chocolate bunnies with a Bunsen burner. Now, have a look at this experiment. We have a Fleur T1020, which can see temperatures up to 2,000 degrees Celsius.
Yeah, you can see that. The glass is getting really hot already.
And after just a minute?
Okay. It's definitely melting. Oh, yeah, here we go. Who's in the finish game? We've got a liquid chocolate situation. We have some smoking bunny. Over here, the bunny is actually sort of melting over. And look, it's sort of tilting to the side.
I think we're going to call that a
What is that? Not only did the bunny melt quickly, the petri dish cracked under the thermal expansion. So now let's try the aerogel.
Oh my god.
So how was aerogel invented?
Back in 1931, a guy named Professor Samuel Kistler had a bet on his colleague Charles Lerman.
Now the bet revolved around jellies, like peanut butter and jelly jellies. And the thing about jellies is they are actually a combination of liquids and solids. I mean, they're mostly liquid, but it's embedded within this 3D solid structure.
So if you think of a gel, like jello has a skeleton with nano-sized pores that gives it its rigidity, and then that's about 1% of the gel.
So the bet was this: could you remove the liquid from the jelly without affecting the solid structure? I mean, if you just evaporate the liquid out, well, then the solid structure shrinks. Because as you remove liquid molecules, they pull on each other, and they pull on the solid structure around them, basically crumbling it from the inside. Now, Samuel Kistler solved this problem in two ways. First, he realized you could replace one liquid with another inside the jelly just by washing it thoroughly. So you can swap out, say, water for alcohol. And then you can take the jelly and put it in a high-pressure vessel called an autoclave
by heating it to the high-temperature, high-pressure point called the critical point of the liquid. That liquid transformed into a semi-liquid, semi-gas called a supercritical fluid.
At this point, there is no longer a distinction between liquid and gas. Those molecules are no longer pulling on each other.
So once you depressurize the vessel, that solid skeleton, that 1% of the mass of the gel, is left behind intact. Except for where there was liquid in the pores before is now gas. And that solid skeleton, that nanopore solid, is what we call aerogel.
Okay, so that's what I'm going to show you on this part. And I'm going to skip all the way to the very end application.
Deep to the top of the aerogel. This is called the Knudsen effect.
It is so weird because, you know, you don't expect something that's transparent to block the heat that well, but this really does.
And that's why NASA used aerogel insulation on the Sojourner rover, Spirit and Opportunity, the Curiosity rover, and they plan to use it on future missions to Mars. Why does it need insulation?
The electronics, because they don't want the electronics to get cold during the cold nights on Mars.
NASA has also put aerogel to more exotic uses, notably to catch dust from a comet as part of the Stardust mission.
So the particles were traveling at about 6 kilometers per second relative to the aerogel. So when they hit the aerogel, because the aerogel is a very low density material, very, very porous material, the particles actually enter the aerogel, and as they travel through the aerogel, they basically break apart the network that makes up the aerogel, and they lose energy in the process and eventually come to a stop. This is good for capturing particles because if a particle like that were to hit a solid surface, then it just stops, you know, immediately.
And just vaporizes.
And vaporizes.
So should we expect to see aerogel in our everyday lives anytime soon?
One of my running jokes is when they build skyscrapers in Antarctica, they'll use aerogel as thermal insulation.
Why do you say that?
Well, because then they'll really care about how thermal efficient it is, because it'd be so cold there. So instead of having, you know, 10 feet of fiberglass insulation, you could have 6 inches or something of aerogel.
The scientists are currently working on reducing costs and increasing durability.
Okay, so that's what I want to show you on the aerogels. And in the textbook, we also mentioned about the density of the bones. Okay, so in here, we mentioned that. And in here, you see that inside the bone structure, there are a lot of empty space in here. Those are the air space here. And I just want to show you, there's a lot more to it. You don't have to understand all of it because that is a lot of information. But, and just give you a taste of what that would be.
The human skeleton gives the body its shape and provides physical support for the systems contained within. It also forms part of the musculoskeletal system and enables us to move. The structure of bone is optimized so that it is strong but relatively lightweight. The interior of bone is composed of bone marrow. It is surrounded by two major types of bone tissue: cortical bone, or the hard outer shell of bone, and trabecular bone, the spongy looking center. The amount of each type of tissue in bone is dependent on the function of that bone. The basic unit of cortical or compact bone is the osteo. It is composed of successive concentric lamellae. This structure contributes to bone strength by resisting bending. Cells called osteocytes are distributed within the concentric lamellae. Osteocytes form a complex network that is thought to be important in maintaining the viability and structural integrity of bone. At the center of the osteo is the Purgeon canal. These canals contain blood vessels and nerves. The blood vessels within bone facilitate the exchange between osteocytes and the blood. Trabecular bone is present in the interior of some bones and resists compression. Osteocytes are also contained within its structure and again play an important role in sensing local changes in strength. Trabeculae are covered in a layer of flattened lining cells that are thought to be involved in the dynamic process by which bone is formed and broken down. Bone marrow is found within the interior of bones.
Now your teacher will give you an iron block and an aluminium block larger than those in experiment 6.11. Do you think these blocks have higher densities than those in experiment 6.11? Measure the masses and dimensions of the blocks.
this can be done with measurements.
Then, calculate their volumes and densities. Measure the mass of the stone. Record your result. Measure the volume of the stone using the method below. Hold a measuring cylinder below the spout of the displacement can. Pour water into the displacement can until a little water runs out of the spout. Pour the water collected by the measuring cylinder into the sink. Tie the stone with a string. Hold an empty measuring cylinder below the spout, and then lower the stone gently into the water in the displacement can. The volume of the stone is equal to the volume of the water displaced into the measuring cylinder. Record your result. Repeat previous steps using plasticine.
Okay, so now let's take a look at this experiment. Now again, in here, unfortunately, we do not have the results for it. So we only can show you the final answer of what it looks like. So in here, the only one I can tell you for sure is that the plastic line is 1.8 in terms of density. Now, let's turn to the next page to Ch6.10 and take a look at some of the questions. The unit of density is cm cubed per gram. True or false? You should realize it. The mass should be the first one comes up. So per cm cube. It's not this way around, it's the other way around. Next, ripping an object in half reduces its density by half. Is this true or false? It's false as well. Because the density doesn't change even if you divide it in half. Because if you divide the whole object in half, the mass, the weight itself, will divide by half as well. So that's why if this one is divided by half, on top, in terms of the volume, the mass will also be divided by half as well. So that's why the density would not change. Now, in here, consider 1 kilogram of cotton and 1 kilogram of iron. Which one have a greater mass? They both have the same mass. 1 kilogram is 1 kilogram. Doesn't matter if it's 1 kilogram of cotton, 1 kilogram of mass of iron, or 1 kilogram of water. It's all 1 kilogram. That's why it doesn't change. Which of them have a higher volume? Cotton. Because of the low density, you will require a high volume of cotton to be 1 kilogram. It will be around the size of your desk. And how about 1 kilogram of iron? It's really compact. You can hold it around the size of your fist, and that's almost 1 kilogram of iron already. So in here, you can tell that this one will take up a lot more space. This one will take up less space. But both of them have 1 kilogram. And that's why you can tell that which one have a higher density, higher volume. So in question 3, we have 2 different blocks, P and Q. The first part is determining the volume of P. Again, the volume is length times width times height. Length times width times height. So in here, the first part, the volume of P is 2 times 2 times 2 equals to 8 squared per cm cube. And in the volume of the block field is 1 cm times 2 cm times 4 cm, which gives you 8 squared per cm cube, which is exactly the same. And next part, we want to determine the density of P, which is the mass divided by volume. Mass is 16 grams divided by 8. Give you 2. And for Q is 16 divided by 8. It's also 2 grams per cm cube. So in here you can tell that the density of this one should be 16. This one should not be 16. This number here, it should be 12. It's 12 divided by 8. So in here you refer to the fraction. In here is 12 gram, so this one is 12 gram. There's a typo in the answer. So in here is 12 divided by 8. This number should be 1.5, so this number is wrong. It's 1.5 here. Now, and in question 4, we're trying to determine the density of the wall. And in here, the first thing we need to do is determine the volume. You can tell by looking at this is 70 and this is 50. So 70 minus 50 gives you 20 centimeter cube. So that is the volume of this wall. And the wall weighs 50 gram, so that's why it's 50 gram divided by 20. So there's a little bit different here, it's 70 divided by 50. So the textbook here is, the answer is wrong, it's 70 minus 50 equals to 20. And this block itself is 50, so this one should be 50 divided by 20 here to give you 2.5. So again, the mass of this is 50 gram, and the cm cube here should be 20. This calculation is wrong here. It should be 20. And so this 50 divided by 20 gives you 2.5. So this number is wrong. So make sure you realize that. Now in here, the last bit here is on the folding and sinking of material. So in here, you can take a look at it and you can tell the X, is it good or not? Does it sink or does it fold on the top? So in here, those that sink are still French, while those who fold are watermelon. This one are watermelon because of the reason is obvious. Because it's water, there will be more air inside, and it will be generated by your density, it will go up. Okay, so how do we decide is it fold or sink? It's determined by density. In most of cases, we're looking in at water. Okay, so does it have lower or higher density than water? And it determines does it sink or not. If the density is heavier, then if this number is higher, it will sink. So in here, ice won't have steel online. Comparing to water, it's 1 gram per cm pure. So we are always comparing in terms of water. So does it have a lower number or higher number than 1? If it's lower number, it will be falling on the water, okay? So in here, the iceberg will fall. And the sea water, again, is around 1.03 in terms of density, it's similar to 1. So in here, the iceberg will fall on top of the water. For iron, it's 7.9 compared to water, just 1. Then it will sink to the bottom. Next example is oil. Oil have a lighter density than water, the soup. That's why in here, you can separate the oil with the soup this way. And also in Dead Sea, you'll be able to flow because in the Dead Sea, you contain a lot more salt. It's a lot more salt here. That's why in here, it's 1.24. Comparing to our just normal seawater, it'll be 1.03. So this one's number is higher. So in our body, it's around 1.026. So in here, please compare this number to this number. This number is lower, so that's why it will fall on top of the Dead Sea. That's the reason we compare the Dead Sea number. Now in here, we've got a density column, and let's take a look at the video.
The following substances are provided: oil, water, sugar syrup, cork, hardwood, iron nail. Put different substances into a gas jar one by one. Sugar syrup. Water. Oil.
So you see it separate by itself. Because of different density.
Cork. Hardwood. Iron nail. This setup is called a density column.
Okay, so in here I'll show you another video of the density column. I think the ones on the YouTube actually generates better density columns than that. And I'm not going to show you the video. And here, this one is some predictions. It might be varying, so I'm not going to spend time on this one. And the next experiment is 6.15, and we're trying to make a pass line, does it fall or not? So in here, if you look,
shape a lump of plasticine into a ball and put it into the beaker of water. Does the plasticine ball float or sink? Dry the plasticine and shape it into a boat. Slowly put it into the beaker of water again, as shown. Does the plasticine boat float or sink? Fully immerse the plasticine boat into the beaker of water as shown and release it. Does the plasticine boat float or sink?
Okay, so this part I'm going to ask you to do it. here, let's go to the last key point here. The last thing to do is a substance with a lower density falls on top of liquid with higher density. And its overall density is lower, you can throw it on water. And let's do the checkpoint. Now, in here, we got four different substances and true or false. Ice flow in the petrol. So we compare these two and we see which one have a lower number. This one have a lower number than this one. So this one will flow and this one will have water. So this one is on top, this one is sink to the water. So it's false. It will not flow, it will sink. How about mercury? Does it sink in water? So mercury is really heavy in terms of density, it's 13.6 compared to 1. So it will sink for sure. Now, if we have 0.5 kg of the ice flowing in water while a 2 kg of ice cube will sink, does it happen? False. Because the ice cube is ice cube. Doesn't matter the size of it, it's 0.5 kg or 2 kg. Both of them have 0.92 grams per centimeter cube. We compare this number to 1. If it's lower than 1, it will fall. Doesn't matter the size, 0.5 or 2 kg, it will still fall on top of it. So this is false. And now in here, we've got the solid rock that sinks in water but falls in mercury. Should have a density between 1 and 13.6. 1 is water and 13.6 is mercury. So does it make sense for it to sink in water and then fall on mercury? So numbers should be between these two numbers. So it is true. It will happen like that. Some number, as long as between 1 and 13.6, it will fall in between these two numbers. And it will sink in water, but fall on mercury. So in here, let's take a look at this container. We've got four different liquids and four different solids here. So in this experiment, we will compare that and we're only looking at the W, this liquid is W, and the lower part of this liquid is Z. So in here, let's take a look. M will fall in the W for sure. So the blue one will be always there. So this one, you'll see that D is incorrect for sure. And the star is Q, this one here, Q. In here, it will fall in here and in here. So in this case, C is warm as well. So we don't need C, we don't need to look at C anymore. And only one left here makes sense is if this one and this one, the numbers are between those two numbers. So it will be falling in the middle. It will not fall on top. If it falls on top like this, these two materials will have the same density. That's why B is incorrect. The only answer is A. Because these two, as long as it's between these two numbers in there, these two rocks will be falling in the middle. So only A is correct. Now, the last bit on the temperature change in the density. So in here, you will understand the temperature change, how it affects the density. So in here, when the density, you can see that when the temperature is as rise, it's heated, it's more further apart, and from that it expands, it's thermal expansion. And you also know that in here, when it's heated, the density will become lower. It will decrease in terms of density because the volume increases, right? Now, similarly, when it's cooler in the thermal contraction, if the volume will become smaller, it will contract, it will be smaller. And now, we can say that when it contracts, the volume decreases. Volume decreases, mass remains the same, therefore, the density increases, it's more dense than before. The
one gas jar with hot water and the other with cold water. Add some red paint to the hot water and mix it gently. Repeat the step by adding blue paint to the cold water. Cover the cold water with a plastic card and hold it as shown. Put the cold water on top of hot water as shown. Carefully pull out the plastic card. Repeat the steps again with hot water on the top this time. Put out the plastic card and see what happens again. You will set up the apparatus shown. Your teacher will then use an alcohol lamp to heat the air inside the plastic bag. What do you observe about the plastic bag?
see the plastic bag becomes inflated and rises. And if you draw in what's happening with the air particles, so you see that there are the air particles are actually, there are less air particles inside in here than the outside. So you can see there are only 4 of it in here. So before that, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's 7 particles inside here. But in the inflated case, with hot air, only a couple more will be here. And this is general energy. So in here, you see that how does the particle, how does the air balloon work? It's with the hot air. The air particle will move faster and it will be further up. You see, there are fewer particles here, but they're moving faster. Expands, so the density increases. And as a result, its lower density than the surrounding air will go up and rises. Now, this two part I'm going to talk about too much. In here, just the cold air will be less dense, will be denser than the warm air. The warm air will be on top, the cold air will be at the bottom because of the density difference. So that's why you base the air conditioner on top, the cold air will come down because it will sink the water in the room, so that the room can be colder more evenly and more effectively.